the magnetics and how to get the flux values and all in a normal magnetic circuit. And what we have found that instead of solving the elaborate Maxwell equations, we can go for some simplification and using some of the approximations or some of the assumptions which are more or less correct, we can actually solve these equations as a linear magnetic circuit. So a single valued magnetic circuit. So where we can define our MMF, which is basically the excitation, and we can find an equivalent quantity which is called reluctance, and then we can equate these two, the reluctance, MMF and the flux, these three quantities in this manner. So this is what we have seen, and this is analogous to our simple Ohm's law, V equal to IR what we have. So otherwise, if we have to solve in general, get the very accurate value of flux at every point in the core or anywhere, we need to go for solving the Maxwell equations where any finite element method or something could be useful. Now, this way of operating or way of solving the circuit is also true if we have some small air gap or some other source of MMF introduced in the circuit. So we can add those linearly. So reluctance and other MMFs can be computed, and again they can be added and solved easily. Only thing we need to keep in mind that the fringing effect should not be so high. So by that, what I mean is the length or the air gap should not be very comparable to the square root of the cross section of that phase. So this LG should be very, very small compared to the core area, AC, square root of the core area. So then we went on to correlate this with our electrical circuit, and what we find that we can define some equivalent electrical quantity, which is our flux linkage and then going towards the inductance. So then we can write electrical equations for this magnetic core and we can solve. That is another way of doing it. So there we can also see how we have a generic equation, generic KVL equation, where our L and I both may vary. So we can find this sort of equation. There could be some resistance also, so then one IR component could also be added over here. So this will all hold true. Now, if we have system where our L is constant, then we need to go for only first part of the right-hand side equation, that is LdI by dt. And if we have I constant some way and we are varying our inductor or inductance, then we can take the second part of the right-hand side equation and we can solve the circuits. So different scenarios, we encounter different situations. For example, in transformer, we have fixed value of inductance as long as we are within the saturation. So using only the first part of this right-hand side, we can solve the equation. Whereas if we go for some moving part machine, let's say reluctance motor or something, then we need to go for the second part as well. So whether to use the first part also, that is our choice, how we want to go. Then we saw if there are multiple MMF sources, how the mutual and self-inductances are defined, and then these things are related to our electrical circuit and we can solve that. Then we tried to saw some properties of the material, which is the BH curve in general we know. And this is also called a DC magnetization circuit, this curve. So here what we are trying to see that if we have air as the medium where we are trying to induce or trying to have some flux density, so we need to give some excitation, which is H. This is what we are giving. And because air has very small permeability, which is mu naught, so that's why this slope of the line is very, very low. So which means we need to put lot of H for attaining a reasonable value of BG. So whereas if we have any magnetic material, there the permeability is much more higher compared to air, which means the component which is coming, something called as relative permeability mu r, this has value something like 2000 or 3000 or something like that. So then our curve is much more steep. But the problem with any practical ferromagnetic or any magnetic core is that there is a limit up to which this B value can be achieved. So that is what is called saturation. We cannot attain any higher value than the maximum limit, maximum flux density of the material, B max. So this is where we enter into saturation, and then we have no choice. Whatever further we increase H, our B will not change. So basically what is happening, if we take this equation B equal to mu H, so up to this linear part we have mu value constant.
Sir, slides are not changing, sir.
Changing means?
Means, sir, you are telling about BH curve and on I can see only previous slide, means this okay. Phi is equal to MF upon reluctance.
Sir, this is happening with me also.
Okay, let me share it again. Okay, now is it there?
So only black screen is visible. So only black screen is visible.
Black, sir. So the connection is lagging, I think.
Yes. For everyone, this is the case.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, let me share it again. This is happening since beginning or just now it started happening?
Since beginning only, sir, it's lagging.
Oh, you should have told, no? Okay, now is it fine or not?
No, sir.
Okay, then let me join again. Okay, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Screen is visible now?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
For everybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let me know if there is any glitch. You should tell immediately. That's why I ask for feedback. Okay. So yeah, till now we were only seeing what we had discussed yesterday. So by saturation, what I meant, this is what I was telling. So when you are increasing this excitation H, your B is changing. So up to the point where it is going in linear fashion, your mu is supposed to be constant, or mu is actually constant. And when the moment you enter this flatter part of the curve, this non-linear part of the curve, this is where your B stops responding as, I mean, compared to how you are increasing the H relatively. So which is where our mu starts changing. It starts varying. And once the limit is reached, which is our maximum flux density is reached for the material, the mu will actually become equivalent to mu naught. So the material will start behaving like air. So you need to put lot of excitation for any further increase in the magnetic flux density, so which will become like unnecessary. So this is what we have seen. Now, some more things related to this. So this is DC magnetization curve, what we know as, because the excitation we are giving only in one direction, only positive excitation we are giving. Now, this B equal to mu H and lambda equal to Li, these two are basically the same equations, only this is at the microscopic level, or you can say at point level. So at every point of material, even if you take a small piece of material or take a complete magnetic circuit. This will always be true, B equal to mu h. So this is true for any particular material in any form, any shape. But lambda equal to Li is something which is derived from mu, B equal to mu h, and this is valid only for a system level. So this is nothing. If you have the multiplications properly, let's say you multiply by n into a on both the sides, so then this becomes your lambda, and you multiply by L on both the sides, so this h into L is your MMF, so mu na by L times of your, okay, here it should be ni, so this is how this is related. This quantity is basically your inductance. So the moment you say B equal to mu h, this is valid for each and every point of that particular material. So whether it is in some proper magnetic shape form or it is just a piece of material, this property holds true. But the system level derived form of the same equation B equal to mu h is valid only for a correct magnetic circuit. If you change the form of the magnetic circuit, let's say you have a C core and then you change it, make a closed form shape, the L changes for both the circuit and hence the validity of this goes away. So the more generic form is B equal to mu h, and a more system level form is lambda equal to Li. So this is what I mean by equivalent. So when we talk about the magnetization curve, we can switch between BH or lambda I equivalently. So in the same graph, we can represent both. Although scales would be different, but the shape will remain same. Now, let us try to understand what happens when we have AC excitation given for a particular material, magnetic material. So first of all, if it is air, you have a constant line. Mu naught is always fixed number. So whenever you increase the excitation, whether it is H or I, and correspondingly you have B or resultant in terms of lambda, you find that for the AC excitation, your B value moves linearly with the excitation, or lambda value moves linearly with I. So this is the meaning of constant L or constant mu naught. So this is true only for air. But if we take any practical magnetic material, so we all know what happens. So as we increase the excitation, this will go on increasing and then it will flatten where it will reach the maximum value. And once you start coming back, it will not come back to zero value. It will have some residual amount of magnetic field, which is called remnant magnetic field. Or remnant magnetic flux density. So why this happens? Because generally the magnetic materials, if you see, they are like forming several dipoles or magnetic moments inside themselves. Now once a field is applied across that, these all get aligned in one direction. Now once you remove this excitation, still it does not come back to its original value or original orientation. Some might remain inclined to what the excitation was. So that is why it reduces, the amount of magnetic flux density reduces, but not to zero. It comes back to some intermediate value. That is what is called remnant magnetic field. Something what is residual even after removing the excitation. Understanding this point? Clear, right? This is simple BH curve we are discussing.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, if we have to make this remnant magnetic field equal to zero, we need to apply some negative excitation, and that is what we do in AC excitation, and this will go something like this. So for some value, let's say that is called HC, this is coercive magnetic field intensity. For which the excitation will actually come down to zero value. So what we have done, we started from zero, we went to the Bmax, and then when we started coming back, it did not follow the same curve, it followed a different curve, and then it came back and remained at Br for the zero excitation value. Now if we want to reduce this, it will go to zero value only for some negative value of excitation. That is the property of the material. Now these words, it may look little different, but the meanings are very, very simple. Remanent means which is something residual, which is something remaining, something extra what is there without any excitation. Coercive means what we need to apply forcefully. So it is some kind of force you are applying to bring it back to original value. Understanding my point, it is something like a spring. If you stretch it, it will go to some length, but if you leave, it will not go to its original value, but it will hang somewhere in between. So you need to apply some force to take it back to its original form. Understanding my point? That is called your coercive magnetic field intensity. Now if you keep on going in this direction, it will follow the curve something like this. And again, on the negative side also, it will go and attain the maximum field intensity. And then while coming back, it will again not follow the mean path, but some other curve. And it will have some residual magnetic field on the negative side. So if you want to remove that residual magnetic field, you need to further apply another positive field intensity to make it to, or to bring it down to zero. And then again, if you try to excite, it will not follow the first line, but it will go on another third curve, and it will go and reach the Bmax. And further, it will move only on these two outer curves and not on the middle one. This is what is called the non-linear behavior of your magnetic material. So if you are operating well within this linear zone, you may encounter, or maybe very, very close to zero. So then you may encounter that very small BH loop is getting formed, which can actually be approximated to a straight line. Only if the excitation and the field intensity is very, very small. But the moment you start going closer to the saturation limits, your property starts changing, the mu starts changing, or the lambda starts, L starts changing. And that is where you have to go for non-linear analysis. Is this clear? Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
You must have studied in your undergrad. Now, there are two types of materials what we encounter in our magnetic circuits, soft and hard materials. So you must be aware of what it is, right? Any comments on this? Any answers? What is soft material? What is hard material?
Soft material easily magnetized and demagnetized.
Yes, correct. And hard material is opposite of that.
Yes, sir.
So where do we use hard material? Where do we use soft material? There are utilization for both the things. Nothing is useless. So what we say, first, if we notice the difference in the magnetization curve, the soft material will have very high mu, so it will quickly get magnetized, and the remanent magnetic field may also be very high, but it will get demagnetized also very fast, and it will form a very thin BH curve like this. Understanding my point? So very easily magnetized, so HC value, the coercive force value, will be very small for the soft material. This is how we identify the soft material. HC value is very small on both the sides. It is very easily magnetized and very easily demagnetized. So where it can be used, any alternating current machine or anything where we do not want any residual magnetic field. This is not required. In DC motors, sometimes self-excited kind of machines where we need some residual magnetism for the machine to start in the beginning. Otherwise, what we need to do, we need to give some separate excitation, shunt excitation or something like that, or separately excited completely. Then only it can start on its own. But for AC machines, many a times we do not want any residual magnetic field. We want it to magnetize very quickly and demagnetize very quickly. So that is the difference, where we want what material. Now, if you have hard material, the property will be little different. It will take some time to magnetize it. Time means in terms of the effort I am saying, like some good amount of H will be required for magnetizing it. So difficult to magnetize, but it is difficult to demagnetize also. So it will form a bigger BH curve or a bigger loop for the BH curve. So where these materials are useful, so wherever, let's say for the DC motor, where we want some residual magnetism to be there. So these are identified by high value of HC, coercive force. So two things, if you notice for the magnetic materials, there are two things which will be very commonly talked about. One thing will be your remanent magnetic field, another thing will be your coercive magnetic field intensity. The third thing could be, that is called the energy curve, which is something like, if you have studied little bit, the energy density, so which means per unit volume, is defined like half of B into H. Correct. So then this product decides or gives how much energy that is containing, that material can contain. If once you magnetize it, how much energy it will contain in itself, how much work you can take from it. And this becomes essential for something called magnets. So what are the properties which we actually look for in magnets? What is the property that we look for? So of course, first what we would want, magnet means what? It is already magnetized. There is huge amount of remanent magnetic field in the magnet. This is the first property we would want, isn't it? This is correct, right? And then
yes, sir.
We would also want that the coercive field intensity HC for the magnet should be very high, which means what? It should not get demagnetized very easily. Is this fine or not?
Yes, sir.
Correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
These two properties we will look for any magnet. Now, let us see how the BH curve for magnet would be. So, because magnet is already having some remanent magnetic field, we generally do not give any excitation for that. We only load that. Only loading means what? You are putting it in some magnetic circuit. Let's say this is your magnet. So you put some soft magnetic material and some other moving part could be there. Something like this, isn't it? So this is all your soft material. And your magnet is there, which is causing the magnetic field lines to be there in the core. And then this plunger could be there, which is moving. So maybe if you attach a spring, every time you move, it will be able to come back to its original position. So by loading, I mean that how much we are putting the demagnetization for this magnet. So if, let us say, the original value is BR over here and you load it, so it will come down to some value. So to understand the BH curve for magnet, what we can do, we can make a simple circuit. Okay, let me take it from PDF if it is there. Yeah. So let us say we take something like this. So at least this will save some time. Now, if you take a permanent magnet material, I am not saying it is magnetized. We are trying to understand the nature or the pH curve corresponding to the permanent magnet. So this material is permanent magnet material means it is soft material. That's what we are trying to understand. And then we keep with a, sorry, this is a hard material. Hard magnetic material. And we are keeping with a soft magnetic material with very high permeability. So mu tending to infinity means compared to air, it is very, very high. Mu r is very, very high. Now, if you put some coil around this circuit, magnetic circuit, and try to excite this, so what will happen? Let us see in this only. Again, it will take some effort to get magnetized. And as you bring down the excitation, it will come back to some remnant value. Now in the same circuit, if you start giving the excitation on the negative side to understand how much HC or coercive field intensity this has, so you will start exciting in the opposite direction, and this is where somewhere it will meet. So this portion of the BH curve defines the complete property about the magnet. So magnets always have the BH curve in the second quadrant, where you have some remnant magnetic field and then you are operating it in some magnetic circuit, so it can only reduce and go back to whatever value it has. Now the question is, if you load the magnet, let's say from its original BR value, and then leave it, will it go back to its original value? What do you suggest? Will it go back to its original value?
No, sir.
Okay, why?
So there is a so if we are changing the excitation, external excitation, then it is going to follow a different path, which is known as recoil line.
Yes, exactly. That is very, very correct. So let's say a magnet is there, which is having BH curve something like this. Now what you do? You load the magnet. Load means whenever you put some magnetic circuit around this, your flux density will come down because different reluctance and all those things will come up. And then this comes to this point, let us say. This is your operating point. And you try to leave it. You remove all the unnecessary things, whatever are there, and you short the magnet perfectly. What will happen? It will never go back to its BR actual value. It will form another small loop. Now every time you load and unload the magnet, it will move on that small curve. This is another, let's say, BR dash. So it will never be able to go back to its original value. And this line, this is called the recoil axis or recoil line. Around this only now the magnet will have the magnetic field intensity. This is another important property what we look for the law, what we look in the magnets, that how far the recoil axis is from the actual BH curve. Understanding my point? So two things, what is the value of BR? What is the value of HC? So this also defines what, how much energy this is containing. Per unit volume, half of BH, and then how far it is coming from the recoil axis. Recoil axis you understood, right? It is similar to a spring If you again pull it and then leave it, by its own mass, by its own friction, it will never come back to its original value. It will be a little bit extended. Now you can only use the limited further length of the spring. So this is what is here. Once it has come down, now this is lost. The actual original value is lost. Understanding my point? Now let us see some examples for different kind of magnets, how they look and what we can expect from them. So some 4 or 5 types of magnets if we see. So what we can expect, what can be called as good magnetic material, what can be called as bad magnetic material. So see, some 4 or 5 types of magnets are explained over here, or the BH curve is given. So first what you see is your Alnico 5 here, it's having very high value of VR, but the HC is also pretty small. Getting my point? So although this magnet is very easy to form, you can very quickly magnetize it, but the moment you try to load, put it in some magnetic circuit, this will demagnetize very fast. So maybe very cheap type of magnetic material, but may not be very useful. Then another type is this, what is called as your Alnico 8. This is having little lower BR, but little higher HC. So somewhere we have compromised, but somewhere we have gained. So some the advantage slide, we have.
Yeah. The slide not changed, sir.
Changed.
Is it not changing for all of you?
Yes, sir. The load is lagging.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Don't know why. What's the issue? Okay, is it visible?
No, sir.
Paritosh?
Sir, now it is not visible. Earlier it was, means I was able to see the slide, that slide.
Now what you are seeing?
Sir, black screen.
Okay, what's the issue? Is it visible now?
Not yet.
Okay, let me connect back quickly once again. Am I visible?
No, sir.
Am I visible?
Yes, sir, have you turned on your webcam?
Yes.
Yes, sir, you are visible.
Yes, sir, you are
visible. It's lagging. Really. Okay, let us see. Now is it visible? My screen is visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yes, so, sir. Yeah, so the moment you see any glitch, please inform. So this now you are able to see this graph what I have put over here.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so some 4 or 5 types of magnets we are trying to discuss over here. First, we saw the Alnico 5, which has very high BR value, but at the same time, very low value of HC. So may be useful for applications where we need lot of remnant magnetic field, but the moment you load it, it goes off. So it cannot take too much of load. So that is the problem with these kind of magnets. Now something, a substitute of that is Alnico 8, which is having little lower BR but little higher value of HC. So somewhere something we are losing and something we are gaining. Understanding? Now another type of material which we got as some ceramic 7, which had even lower value of BR but little bit more higher value of HC. So maybe by putting lot of magnets together we can get some high value of magnetic field this density, magnetic flux density, but at the same time, yeah, we will be able to attain the some higher value of HC. So somewhere something we are compromising and something we are gaining. But with the finding of new type of the rare earth metals and all, we have been able to find some very good magnetic alloys, so which show very high value of BR and very high value of HC. So these are rare earth metals or magnets which are composed of rare earth metals. So this is something, samarium cobalt, which is having BR value little lower than what we were getting for Alnico 5, but HC value much higher than what we have for Alnico 5. So much better substitute for that. And then we can find something like neodymium iron boron kind of magnets, which are like having almost equal BR value as Alnico 5, but the highest HC value among all the options what we have. So these magnets are very, very powerful. You might hear also neodymium magnets and all. These are very costly and very, very powerful magnets. So this is what we look for when we are choosing the magnets, these two things in particular. And then what is the shape of this curve? Now for this magnet, if you have the recoil axis to define, that will be very, very close to this line itself. Recoil axis may not be very far from the line because it's a straight line which is coming over here. Whereas for other shapes, this may deviate a lot. The recoil axis may be very, very different. But for the linear curves, this is very, very close to the actual magnetic, this BH curve. So that is why the recoil magnetic BR value and the actual BR value, these may not be very, very different. So this is another advantage when we have these kind of magnets, neodymium. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Good. Now let us try to put these things in some kind of motion or some kind of machine, how these concepts are utilized. So that's what we will try to see now. And particularly corresponding to SRM motor, what we can have. So let me know if my screen goes off in between, so I will reconnect. Let us say we have a C core magnet or C core electromagnet. So the geometries are more uniform compared to what I am drawing. And you have, let us say, a plunger over here which can move. It is hinged at this point, but if given the excitation, this has tendency to go towards the magnet. Now this is what we will try to understand, what is happening and how this concept can be used for our switch reluctance motor. What is the basic principle behind the reluctance motors? Now here, let us see what is there. So in this position, when our plunger is, let's say, at some LG length away, or the gap between the two faces is LG. So we can define like what flux density we can expect or what flux we can expect in this core for the given excitation N and I and for the given geometry. So that will define the reluctance. Correct? That is clear? That is clear?
Yes, sir.
So in this position, if let us say you try to plot, and this we take some soft magnetic materials which are magnetized very fast, and they do not have lot of coercivity required to bring it back to zero value. So then if you take the lambda I graph, or which is equivalent to BH, that's what we have seen. So because of this huge air gap, the reluctance will be dictated by what is the reluctance of this air gap path. So then for the given excitation, the lambda will move very slowly. Now the rise in lambda will be very, very small. The slope will be smaller. Now this is the characteristic. Now in this position, if you try to compute what is the energy stored in the system, how much it is going to inductance it is going to have and all these things. So from our previous courses, we know that what is called as energy and co-energy, all these things we know, right? This is clear, right, to all of you, or do I need to explain?
Yes, sir.
You know, all of you know this energy and co-energy concept?
Yes, sir.
Yes, everyone, sir. Alaj, are you aware of this?
It's a plan, sir.
No. Good. So basically what we are trying to do, let's say we talk about the power, what we are pumping in our circuit, that would be V into I. And the energy associated with that can be given as VI into DT over the time what we are pumping. So what may happen, we may look for either we are keeping our I constant and varying the V, or we are keeping our V constant or varying the I, depending on what type of magnetic circuit we are having. Now, let's say in terms of field excitation and all, so how we define, so V is basically your d lambda by dt, and when you say power, your power will be V into I, so that will be I into d lambda by dt. So this is what is this, so I mean this kind of change. Okay, let me this small area what you are seeing over here, that for a given I, what is the change in lambda, that is your, that defines how much energy your system is having. So this is what it is. Now both I and lambda are like kind of dependent on each other, so we can find another quantity, let's say L, which is as of now for the given system when we do not go into saturation and all, this is kind of property of the geometry. So we can keep like this, and then our energy, if you compute for, let's say, going from I1 to I2 or from lambda 1 to lambda 2, so you can find the energy can be given as half Li square, or it could be lambda, half of lambda into I, or also you can write as half of some lambda square by I. So all these three forms are correct. This is fine, right? Nothing much complicated. From yes. Here actually I am trying to derive what we are doing basically. So now what happens when you have this energy and co-energy concept? So what we say, that any amount of work done is basically the change in co-energy what we observe in the system. This is correct, right? This is correct?
Yes, sir.
Or the force generated by this magnetic circuit is nothing but the derivative of the co-energy. So let's say U is your co-energy. So we will say like this, with theta or with G, whatever we are doing. So this is our force, or equivalently torque. These kind of things are related with this. This is fine. These are all very simple things. I'm just saying, I'm not going into derivation and all, because there is something more related to magnetic circuit I want to discuss. So this is fine, right?
Yes.
So yes. On account of this, what this system will do basically, this system will generate some amount of torque, because this is hinged. So I'm not using force term over here, and it will try to move this plunger or this arm towards the magnet. So what final position it will have? Something like this. of course, this plunger or this arm that has accelerated, gained some momentum and all. So what we ensure that we may attach some spring where this energy will be stored. When you ask like where this energy has gone, if we have excited, this has come closer to this, where is that kinetic energy? So let's say there is a spring which in which it is getting stored. Otherwise, it will go and hit the plunger or hit the magnet very hard way. No? So now in this position, if you try to have the lambda I characteristic, how this will look like. Now we have different value of L. L has basically what? Reduced or increased? So we have derived L as something like N square by R, right? So whenever we have reduction in R, we find our L to go high. Is that clear?
Yes.
Yes.
So we are operating with higher value of L. So this is the thing, which means we are going to have a much steeper curve for the lambda I characteristic. So far, I have not gone into saturation zone. We are operating perfectly in the linear zone. There is no problem in that. So now, if let us say this was the original I, your lambda has gone to much higher value compared to where it was for the open position. So if I plot both together, how it will look like? This was your original position for the given I and for the given L. Now, once you fix the value of I, you allow the magnet to move, it will follow this path, which means your L is continuously changing. It is increasing. And so is your lambda. The current is fixed. So it will take, let's say you started from O, then you move to point A. Now, if you leave the magnet free, it is moving towards the electromagnet. So then it will go and touch the maximum L point. This is something we may call as L max. This is some point which we may call as L minimum point, where our arm is having some LG air gap. And here there is no air gap. It is perfectly aligned, LG equal to zero. Now, this is our original position for lambda. And now if you slowly reduce the current to zero, because now it is in some position, so we need not excite, so it will, the current can come back to zero. Understanding my point, how the lambda I characteristic has followed this whole magnetic circuit or how this is changing. So in this motion, what we are basically doing, there are two, three parts, let us say one this, So whatever area you see under this, that is basically you see, you know, say, you know, the change in co-energy. That has basically gone into the mechanical work, what is done over moving the plunger or storing that energy in the spring. Of course, when it is moving, that some kinetic energy is gained. It has to go somewhere. So I am putting a spring so that it doesn't go and hit it. It will keep storing the energy in the spring. So this is what the energy is between this OA and let's say the point B. So this is basically the energy associated with your magnetic circuit, which is going for the mechanical work done. Now, when you are reducing the current value from I to zero in from this L max position, what is happening? This upper triangle, let me shade in blue, this energy is returning back to your source. This is kind of no magnetization you have, or magnetization curve you have in the, not curve, I mean the magnetizing inductance you have in the induction motor. So where you give some reactive power and it comes back to the source, it is not lost anywhere. It is this power which I am talking about. This is your reactive power which is coming back to the source. It is only required to magnetize and then bring it back in this particular position of L max. Understanding my point? Now, if we try to put this whole scenario in a more fruitful manner, let us say we have some motor which can, you know, take circular motion. So we have a stator, let's say there are some four poles. So I will put the more better drawing little later. Just indicatively you assume that this is true, okay, this is symmetric, and we have a plunger something like this which has tendency to rotate about this central axis, and you have coils all around these poles. Now same scenario, if you assume that we are having a orientation where it is perfectly unaligned, so we will have the minimum value of L in this position, and there is position where this will be aligned perfectly with, let us say, this, these two poles. So this I will call as L max position, where my inductance is highest. So how the lambda I and these curves will follow, it will be very similar to what we did for linear motion, except here we are leaving it free to move more like a motor. So what will happen if we excite this coil? The lambda will reach some value, and then we hold the current to a constant value. What it will do? It will make this plunger or this rotor rotate so that lambda increases and goes corresponding to the L max value. And then what we do, because we have to keep it rotating, we cannot keep it held over here, so we need to release the excitation also immediately, so that there is, it's free to move. Once it is about to reach in the position, that torque is applied, then you remove that torque. So what it will do? It will keep rotating, and this is how we come back to zero excitation for our coil. So if we rotate this, if we repeat this process continuously, what will happen? This plunger or the rotor will have tendency to go in perfect rotational motion. Understanding my point? So here what is important, that at what point you are exciting the coil, what is the position at which you are exciting this coil, and what is the position where you reduce the excitation to zero. This is important to understand in these kind of motors. And because here we don't have any magnet, we don't have any other source of excitation on the rotor, so that's why these are perfectly working on the principle of reluctance. And these type of machines are called switched reluctance. So why switched reluctance? This is because this, we are giving current only at a particular position, and then we are removing the excitation so that it can rotate freely. Otherwise, if you keep the excitation for a long time, it will remain stuck in this position forever. It will never go further because the magnetic field is very strong here. It will not allow it to go further. So we need to remove that after a certain point. And then what we will be doing? We will be doing the exactly same process repeatedly, again and again, what we did for the linear magnetic circuit. So this curve, what I said earlier, which was getting stored in the spring, now will be responsible for the rotational energy or the kinetic energy or the mechanical, if any load is connected to this mechanical load or fan, so all that will go in that, this energy. Understanding my point? And this,
yes, sir.
First the upper triangle part, this will be returned back to source. This is only for magnetization it is needed. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so maybe a couple of more minutes I will take, or okay, let me just tell one thing. So what we have understood, that a torque generated by the machine or this kind of structure is basically this. This is what we have understood. So it has two things. One is the current and another is the changing inductance. If either of these two quantities are zero, then the torque develops. Sorry, it's not dou tau by dou theta. It is tau. So if either of the quantities, whether the current magnitude or the changing L are zero, the same moment we will have zero torque developed. If it is perfectly aligned to the L max or L min, our dou L by dou theta is zero. That moment we won't generate any torque. And if our I is equal to zero, then also we will not generate any torque. So it's combination of these two that we will see in the next class, how we utilize to make our SRM rotate and which type of SRM structures are basically possible in configuration, which are more useful, how we decide the step angle, how we can make it rotate almost like a perfect sinusoidal motor. So lot of things we can do with these things. Fine. So let's stop here. Any questions you may ask if you have quickly. Any questions?